Welcome to Tech Talk. Today's topic is open liberty. For those that follow this channel, you may have seen my video on cloud-native Java and how it helps enterprise developers extend their investment into tools and skills into the future. Well, today we're joined by Harry Hoots, one of the developers from open liberty. He's going to show us how they implemented a fun demo that knits together lots of technologies using open liberty and a host of other open source projects. For those who haven't seen the game, the way it works is that you have a play table, which is with some planets and obstacles. The players use hand gestures that are detected by a camera to navigate the game board. They have a fixed amount of time, and they have to avoid taking on damage on their way to a destination planet. That's the game itself. This topology diagram shows the different microservices that it uses on the back end, as well as a web server on the front end. With that intro out of the way, Harry, can you explain how this Java EE project got started and what were your goals?
Sure, Dan. One little correction up front, though. So instead of Java EE, it's now Jakarta EE. So Java EE was Oracle's, and they gave that over to the Eclipse Foundation around the end of 2017, beginning of 2018. So now it's controlled by them as an open source project to give you Java EE functionality.
Well, I've been around a little longer, so thank you for that historical
You're
note.
You're welcome. All right, so you want to know more about the game services. So first off, we have the game service itself, which is basically the brainchild behind all this. And it runs on Open Liberty. We've also got the leaderboard service, again, an Open Liberty service. We've got Prometheus and Grafana servers so that we can scrape metrics and display them on a dashboard. We also have a front-end UI where the user walks up and types in their name, sees their score, that kind of thing.
So you've divided this into a number of different services and some other components. Why did you choose to do that, and how did it help you?
Yeah, so microservices architecture gives you a lot of flexibility. If you think about your typical IoT or your Java enterprise application, usually there's a lot of legacy things in there and new things. And so you want to be able to tie all those together. Microservices gives you that flexibility to, you know, take pieces, different architectures, different languages, different hardware, and put all those together. And so that's why we did it, was we wanted to highlight, a microservices type of project that highlighted open liberty and using MicroProfile and Jakarta EE APIs.
So MicroProfile, you mentioned that a few times. That I mentioned in the prior video. If you haven't seen it, be sure and check it out. Where was the payoff there for your team?
Yeah, so again, MicroProfile and Jakarta EE give users, you know, a bunch of APIs developed for cloud native applications, streamlined, that sort of thing. It takes a lot of the time of programming from the developer and gives them back time to actually focus on the logic of the game.
And speaking of the game, now that we've got the big picture, could you kind of walk us through from the user's point of view all the way through these different services, what's going on?
Sure. So again, we've got WebSockets that are bidirectional servers on the hardware and the game service. So when a user, for example, indicates a gesture of left, a message is sent to the game service, okay, and then it's routed over to the physical rover. And so on the physical rover, the Arduino board takes that message, parses it, figures out, oh, it's turn left. And so then it turns the wheels in the appropriate fashion. And so that loop repeats until the player runs out of time in the game. And then throughout the gameplay, there is an RFID sensor in the rover, and then on the different planets that you visit are RFID cards, and then on the obstacles, there's NFC stickers so that damage can be calculated. And so that information is fed back to the game service and again goes to the UI to see your score and damage, et cetera.
And these two, I presume, communicate with each other?
That's correct. They communicate via REST APIs.
Okay.
Yep.
And then, on this end, the same deal?
That's the same thing, a REST API to the leaderboard service.
So by separating this out from your microservices and open liberty components, you were able to have your web developer focus just on that.
That's right. So that's the nice thing about microservices. Typically, you would have an individual person working on a particular service or a small team, depending, you know, if it's a larger type service. But, you know, for example, one person worked on the game service and the leaderboard service, another worked on the UI, another worked on the rover, another worked on the physical map board that was hardware.
Now, I gather you use Prometheus for pulling statistics and showing some sort of things the developer
would
be
interested in? We do. So Prometheus, the way we have it implemented right now is it's pulling JVM information so we can see performance. We also have a timer there so that we can see latency between the hand gestures and the hardware.
Well, speaking of latency, I imagine that the whole goal of this was to deploy this at a conference on a showroom floor. What would that deployment look like?
Yeah, so typically at a conference, Wi-Fi is going to be terrible. So we usually run it on a local box on-prem. The beauty of it is, though, we've also ran it at conferences in the cloud. And you could mix and match those pieces, too, if you wanted to. That's the flexibility of the microservices architecture. You know, run a few pieces in the cloud, run a few pieces local. Just depends on your needs.
That's really the hybrid cloud story, right?
That's correct.
And so, kind of wrap this up, what was the stack that you used? Because there was an awful lot of components. Could you kind of summarize what they were and what they did?
Sure. So let's focus on the Open Liberty. And so what Open Liberty offers is a full open source stack. So we use OpenJ9 as the JVM. We use IBM Cimaru runtimes as the SDK. Open Liberty sits on top of that as our Java runtime server. And then on top of that, Open Liberty implements the specifications for both Jakarta EE and MicroProfile.
Well, for the enterprise developers who are out there watching this, they're probably wondering, how do I take the lessons you learned from this game development and apply it to a business application that they might be doing?
Sure. So again, it fits really well, you know, this type of thing for an enterprise application. This is an IoT implementation, but yet, you know, having this microservice architecture and, you know, having different components, you know, fits very well there.
Okay, that's a great way of extending it. That is for now a wrap. Since you stayed to the end of this video, I bet you want to know more. So let me point you to a couple great resources related to cloud-native Java, microservices, and of course, Open Liberty. First, check out the GitHub repo with the Space Rover mission. You can check out the source code and see the services that Harry just covered. And if you're new to Open Liberty, you can get started quickly with their hands-on guides. They cover how to build your first microservice and then go deeper into cloud-native applications featuring MicroProfile, Jakarta EE, and more. Be sure to check it out in the links below. Before you leave, be sure and leave a like and a subscribe. If there's other topics you'd like to see on Tech Talk, be sure to also drop a comment below.